Welcome, everybody, to beautiful Plymouth, New Hampshire. I would like to start off this meeting, please, with a pledge. I'd like to have Dave Moorhead lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance, please, when all rise.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Quick reminder, if you have cell phones, please turn them off. Thank you. Our guest today has many achievements to his credit. As chair of the Budget Committee in Congress, he led the effort to balance the federal budget for the first time in a generation and served 18 years on the House Armed Services Committee, where he was a strong ally of President Reagan and his national security agenda. He's also had a successful career in business as an investment banker, a New York Times bestselling author, and on Fox News. In Ohio, he was re-elected governor last year by 30 points. So he's doing something right out there in Ohio. After working with his fellow Ohioans to turn an $8 billion shortfall into a $2 billion surplus. And he also cut taxes by $5 billion to make Ohio one of the top job-creating states in the nation. He originally is from McNeese Rocks, Pennsylvania, a blue-collar town outside Pittsburgh, where his father delivered mail for 30 years. He and his wife Karen have twin teenage daughters. Please join me in welcoming Governor John Kasich.
Thank you very much, John. Please sit down, please. So, that's a pretty good resume, by the way, you know. I think I'd vote for him. An underachiever. So, you said about everything. I have nothing left to say. I guess we should go to questions. No, I mean, I grew up, as he mentioned, in a little town outside of Pittsburgh, and my father did carry mail. His father was a coal miner. My mother lived with us, and she came from Yugoslavia, so she could barely speak English. And coming through some of these small towns, you know, like we were just in Woodstock, and the guy running the general store said when the paper mill closed, you know, people have to do two or three jobs. He said when the paper mill was going, there were always new cars out in the three shifts. And, you know, when economics goes south, then we know what happens. As we were talking even in Woodstock about the drug problem here in New Hampshire. And as he pointed out to me, you know, when people don't have those jobs, we get depressed, you get isolated, bad things always happen. And I grew up in a place where we saw the pain of people who were losing jobs, you know. So it's something that it's kind of in your head, right? It's something that's in your heart. You understand that when people can't work, what happens to families and communities. And that's why our greatest moral purpose for those who serve in government is to create an environment where jobs can happen, you know, particularly jobs for small businesses. And small businesses are so delicate that whenever I see somebody in a small business, I say, well, how long have you been in it? Like this guy in this bakery down there, he's been like 3 months, 4 months, you know, he's very delicate. And it's easy for the government at any level to come in and snuff people out with overtaxing or silly regulations. I mean, it gets to be a problem. And I think we have to always think that when we do things, what is the impact on somebody's job whenever we do things in the government? So anyway, I left that little town and I went to a small school in the Midwest called Ohio State University. I don't know if you've ever heard of it. And I was there a short period of time and became frustrated and asked for a meeting with the president of the university. 48,000 students were at that school, and it took me a while to get in, but I badgered my way in, and I went in to see the president, and he had an impressive office and was an impressive man. And I walked in, and he asked me what was on my mind. I told him, and I looked at him, and I said, "Sir, I've been at school about a month, and I'm undecided, but looking at your assistant who kept me out in your office, your rugs, your furniture, your desks, maybe this is the job for me because I'm undecided. What exactly do you do?" And so he told me about his fundraising and his academic responsibilities, and he told me he was going to go and see President Nixon the next day. And I said, "Well, sir, there's a number of things that I would like to talk to him about also. Could I go with you?" And he said I could not. And I said, "Well, if I write a letter, would you give it to him?" To make a long story short, I get a letter back from the office of the president, the White House, and I call home. My mother answers the phone, and I said, "Mom, I'm going to need an airline ticket. The President of the United States would like to have a meeting with me in the Oval Office." And my mother is shouting, "Honey, pick up the phone. Something's wrong with our kid." It's a true story. So they got me an airline ticket. I flew to Washington, and I went in through security, and I'm right outside the Oval Office, and they said, "I'm 18 years old, just finished my first quarter." A guy walks up to me and says, "You get 5 minutes alone with the President of the United States." You say, "Wow, tell you what I'm thinking. 5 minutes? I got a new jacket, shirt, tie, pants. I'm not coming out in 5 minutes. I didn't come all this way for five lousy minutes." So they opened up the door, and I walked in, and the president greeted me, and I greeted him, and I sat at his desk for 20 minutes. And but I was in Congress for 18 years, and if you add up all the time I spent in the Oval Office, I peaked out at the age of 18. I should have moved to Plymouth, huh? So, you know, that's a story. Isn't that an amazing story? And my mom and dad, God bless them, they couldn't believe it. And they couldn't believe really my whole career, because we just didn't come from that. You know, my uncle wasn't a congressman. I mean, so all these things that I was doing, I really never really talked about this. They were so flabbergasted. And, you know, what's so interesting about it is the definition of what our country can be, where anybody can become whatever they want. And these success stories are stories that we're all hungry for, aren't we? Because we all want to believe in the promise of America. You believe because the Cubs are going to go almost to the World Series. I mean, that's a believer. Give him a round of applause for the Chicago Cubs. But I became a state senator when I was 26 years old. I knew no one. I went to my first Republican meeting, and I was pulling on the Republican chairman's coat, and I said, "I want to run for the state Senate." And the guy's like, "Go away, kid. You bother me, you know." I finally got picked because they said, "This guy just will not leave us alone." He will not leave us alone, and what the heck, we're not going to win the seat anyway. So I went out, and we got one of my friends here. I've known her for 38 years. Hadn't seen her for, 15 years? She got involved in my very first campaign and went door to door, and I won an unbelievable victory into the state Senate. I was the youngest ever elected, and I went in there and shook a lot of stuff up when I was there, because I'm not going into office to be a Republican or a Democrat. I'm just walking in here with a person in the media because we're going to have a big plan we're going to release tomorrow to fix this economy. And he said, "Who are you going to get mad?" And I said, "Well, it doesn't really matter to me. What would it matter to me? Why would I be worried about who's going to be mad at me? Why would I be up here if I just didn't want to do the things that I know need to be done to fix the economy?" So I went to Congress at the age of 30 and became a military reformer, because I was one of the people that found the hammers and the screwdrivers and the wrenches that cost tens of thousands of dollars. And I became convinced that if it doesn't matter where the waste is, if the waste is in the welfare department or the waste is in the Pentagon, get rid of it. We can't tolerate waste, particularly over there in the Pentagon, where if we're wasting money, we're taking the resources we need out of the hands of our men and women who are out there on the front line. And but I believe in a very strong military. It needs to be rebuilt, by the way. You know, the plan we'll have tomorrow is going to show a significant increase in defense spending because we have to do it. And then 6 years in, I got on the budget committee, and I didn't like President Bush's budget, and I didn't like the Democrat budget, so I offered my own. And I didn't do very well. My vote was 405-30, and I had the 30. And the second time I offered a budget, my newspaper, hometown newspaper, because you have to pay attention to hometown newspaper, came to me and they said, aren't you embarrassed that I had 64 votes, I think, the second budget? Aren't you embarrassed that you're not doing better? I said, look, if I'm the only one voting for it, that's all that matters, because I think I know what we need to do. My third budget, by the way, I got more votes than the president got for his. Now, how much fun do you think it was for me to be offering budgets against a Republican president? That wasn't comfortable, but I'm not in this business to be comfortable. I'm in this business to bring about change. So I spent 10 years fighting to balance the budget. Why? We don't have a right to put our kids into all this debt because we're living high on the hog or we're not taking care of business. After 10 years, I became the chief architect of the first time we balanced the budget since man walked on the moon. And we paid down the largest amount of the publicly held debt in modern time. We cut taxes on risk-taking and investment. And if you think back into the end of the 90s and into the next century, we were doing really, really well. And when I left Washington, we had a projected $5 trillion surplus. Can you believe? I mean, it sounds like this can't be true. It's like something out of a fiction novel, right? But it's true. And then I left, and my friend back here, Congressman Shays, who's driven up here from Maryland 8 hours to come and spend time with me, he said at the time, when you leave, this place is going to fall apart. And a bunch of my buddies and I left, and Chris, it fell apart, didn't it? They spent it all because there was nobody there to say no. And it was, frankly, in some respects, it's a catastrophe to see that happen because we had enough of a projected surplus to really help fix Social Security for young people, and they blew it. So I went out for 10 years, and you heard about some of the things that I've done, and you recall my total stardom when I was at Fox News. I was really big. Did you know that? You don't remember that. Okay. I have tapes in my car. I'll give them to you. You know, you all watch O'Reilly. You know, I was a guest host of O'Reilly for 10 years. Yes. Did you ever watch O'Reilly?
No.
Okay. What did you watch there?
Not a lot of
TV. Good for you. What is your business?
I was in the metal stamping business supplying the automotive industry, but I now work for a German company that makes equipment inspecting utility poles and things and whatnot.
So it didn't make you happy to be out of the automotive?
No, it did not.
Yeah,
that
so
was
we
not
could,
really my choice.
And we could talk about that. So I went back in to run for governor. I told my wife, I said, sweetie, I was out for 10 years. And I'll be very honest with you. I feel like my life has been blessed. I have beautiful daughters and great wife and a lot of things from that little town in McKees Rocks. The Lord's been good to me. So, you know, he's good to you. You better be listening. So I went back and I told my wife, sweetie, I'm going to have to run for governor. And she said, well, that's just really great. So I went in and things were really a mess and I had to shake everything from top to bottom. And just tell you an interesting story. Right after I was elected, there was a gathering of lobbyists, special interest groups, and they were at this lunch, and the press was there. They weren't there, but they heard. So I got up, and I said, there's going to have to be a lot of changes in this state, and many of you are going to try to decide that you don't like the changes I'm proposing, and you're going to fight my changes. I said, but you're not going to win. So let me give you a little advice. Either get on the bus or I'm going to run over you with the bus. And they didn't cotton to that, right? And then the press went and wrote that I was yelling this at the people, which, of course, I wasn't doing. I was talking to special interest groups, because when you go to do things, you have to cut through the status quo and the resistance that you get. So we went from $8 billion in the hole, 20% of our general revenue fund, to where we now are running a $2 billion surplus. We had lost 350,000 jobs, and we've gained now 347,000 jobs. Pretty good, isn't it? Our unemployment has dropped significantly. Our wages are going up faster than the national average. We killed the death tax so small businesses could pass their business on, and that was good. And now we're working on killing death. That one we're not that far along on yet. We basically have eliminated all taxes for small businesses in the state of Ohio on income taxes. And our credit is really strong. And we are helping people who live in the shadows. Now, here's a really interesting thing that I feel really good about that I wish the media wasn't here to hear, wasn't here to hear, because we have been working, fighting the problem of drugs for now over 5 years. So I rode with the chief of Lincoln. Yesterday I had lunch with the chief of Tilton. And these guys are very connected in New England, and we've got a lot to share with them. And we know that some of the things that we need to do, because we've been working in this so long. So wouldn't it be great? And they're all going to be in Chicago together. I called my head of public safety, and I put them on with these guys. Wouldn't it be great if together we could all work on a strong public policy effort to try to have a war against these drugs? That's a real bonus for me. And when I go home and my kids and my wife, my kids are 16, not quite, but when I get home, I'm going to tell them. You know, Dad's not only out here running for president, but there's some good things that can come immediately from this opportunity to be out and be with all of you. So we take care, we try to have the resources to treat the mentally ill and the drug addicted and the working poor so they can get on their feet. They can live out their God-given purpose, which I think is really critically important. And then finally, I want to talk to you about something else. And this is not something that a president can legislate, or any governor can legislate. We all have to realize that, and some people are going to be they're not going to share this view, or they could be humanists, and that's fine, because their job is to improve the world. But I think we all have to realize that we do answer to a higher power. I think we do realize that in that means that we have responsibility. I think it means that we have to work to strengthen our families. I think we have to work to care about our neighbors. I think we have to live lives a little bit bigger than ourselves. And I believe that if, in fact, we can make a commitment, all of us, about our families, about our neighbors, about what we can do to help people do better in life as we help ourselves, that's going to revive something in America that I think has been dim. Do you agree with that, man?
Sure.
It's been dim. President can't write a law to fix that. Oh, there might be a few things that we can do. But at the end of the day, we focus on electing a president. We don't run this country from the White House down. We run this country from right where we live up, don't we? Mm-hmm. And we've got to get the confidence and the spirit. So one of the things that I'm going to do is shift a lot of power out of Washington. You're going to see it. I'll give you one example. The Department of Education has 100 separate programs with 100 separate bureaucrats and 100 separate strings and 100 separate red tape. And we're going to bundle those programs into 3 simple block grants, and we're going to send it to the states and say, you run education where you live. We're not going to run it out of Washington anymore. But as we can shift power and reduce taxes, then that's going to empower us to revive this country. And I think we need that, frankly, more than anything else, because everything then flows from there. So I'm optimistic about our country. We're great. We have a residue of strength, and it's important to us. And so I want to go in there and help fix things. That's why I'm doing this. I'm doing it to go live in that white building. I want to do it because I think I know how to turn the dials. I think I know how to bring people together of both parties to achieve something, not just talk about something like some clanging bell on the street corner where I'm just going to yell all these things I'm going to do but don't have a clue how it works or how to get it done. I just suggest to all of you, be careful. We are not picking American Idol, okay? We're picking somebody to run America, and we better make the right pick. So, thank you. And boy, is that a great quote, huh? Want me to repeat that again? We are not picking somebody from America or Idol. We're picking somebody to run America. Clap again. That was a good one, okay? Okay, what do you want to know? Ask whatever questions. Yes, sir, right here, sir. No, ladies first. Ladies first. Is that your wife?
Yeah.
Wow.
I've got a Facebook friend that's put a lot of it. She's very upset about what's going on with Cuba. And nobody seems to be talking about the change that Obama made there.
Well, I don't know why we're trying to reward people who haven't changed. I haven't seen any change out of the Castros. So to me, they ought to change a little bit before we do anything. That's my view. Seems like we've made more friends with more people that we've never gotten along with and made more or created bad relations with people that we've always liked. I don't get it. So with Cuba, I don't like what the president's doing there. Yes, sir.
If you could stomach any of what went on last night on the Democrat
side. I was at Beebe's house. He's Bruce Berkey. We call him Beebe. And we couldn't get the television.
Aww.
Wasn't that a shame? Huh? That way, they had a little bit on the computer, but it was too hard, so I really didn't see any of it.
One of the biggest things that they talked about was more gun control.
Yeah.
Okay? And it got to the point where it absolutely made me sick.
Did you keep watching or did you turn it off?
NCIS.
Oh, NCIS, huh? Okay, well, look, I think the problem, first of all, the gun laws we have ought to be enforced, okay? They ought to be enforced. And secondly, everybody wants to focus on the gun, but what we ought to be focusing on is the fact that a lot of these people have mental illness. A lot of these people are all alone. The mother of the shooter in Oregon didn't know where to turn. I'm wondering, where's the dad? Where's the brother? Where's the sister? Where's the neighbor? So in my state, we just don't leave these things unattended, and in the country, we shouldn't leave it unattended. We need to deal with mental illness, and we need to deal with the fundamentals of where was anybody? Where the heck were the people that are connected to that family? Am I right on this, or am I?
Exactly right.
I mean, we cannot ignore these things in our community. We can't ignore these things in our family. We have to be involved. Now, sometimes it can get so bad that there's not much we can do. I just like to see effort. And so I got to tell you that I was on The View the other day. You ever watch it? It was great. I got a hug from Whoopi. I mean, what could be better than that? It was Joy Behar's birthday. I got to talk to her about her truck-driving father and her mother, who was a seamstress. It was like the same place I came from. And I find they just wanted to talk about the guns. The gun is the easy thing to talk about. And we're not going to take them away from people who are going to do us harm anyway. That's just not going to work. It is not a practical solution. But what I find is many of us are unwilling to go deeper. What is the root cause of this? Why are these people so angry? Why are they so isolated? Why are they so polarized? And why are we not doing anything about it?
Exactly.
And so, sir, I think that's where we need to focus and enforce the gun laws that we have. You buy a gun at a gun show, it's up to the person at the gun show to find out who you are. And we don't want to be selling guns to people who are unbalanced. And there's a law, and some of the states are just ignoring the law. They're not posting. Using their technologies to who shouldn't get a gun. Nobody in this room wants somebody to get a gun that's not stable. So, we can do that. But let's think about the deeper issues that we face.
One other problem is that people don't teach their children respect of firearms.
My son is the chief of police of Woodstock, New Hampshire. From him all the way down to my youngest grandchild, I taught them.
I was just with the chief. He's on the road with me. He's for me for president, by the way.
Right.
I guess I should announce
that. We need to teach our children respect, and they keep yelling for more gun, more gun checks.
Let me ask you this. We have to teach them. We have to teach our children to have respect for firearms. But why don't we teach them also to have respect for their elders, for their teachers? And why don't we all teach one another to have respect for the President of the United States? It doesn't mean we have to agree with the President. But we can't just be trashing every institution in this country. I mean, if we're trashing the church, the President, the business, I mean, come on. Let's get out of this. And we can be critical, but we can show respect. You know, my daughters, and let me be clear so they don't go on TV. I respect the president, the office of the president, but I profoundly disagree with what he does, okay? Just write that down. I talked to one of my daughter's teachers. Don't tell anybody, okay? You know what the teacher said? Your daughter is delightful because even if she has ideas that are not consistent with what we teach in the class, because she thinks big. She thinks big. Where she thinks big. But your daughters, they're the delight because they're so respectful. And you know, we try to teach the young people around us. Respect takes you so far. You know, so that's another kind of fundamental American principle, right? We got to do better at this. We got to do better at it. Yes, sir. Cubs fan?
Yeah, Cubs fan. You have character, and you have a...
I'm a flawed man, so let's not get carried away with my saying.
As a University of Minnesota graduate, I know you have a flawed character going to Ohio State.
Yes. It's okay. Ohio State was in Minnesota, and you guys beat our players up on the floor. Do you remember that?
I remember a lot of
that. Okay.
My question is, you have character, resume, and achievements, but it seems what buys the day nowadays is flamboyance. How the heck do you deal with that to get to the point where you can actually help the country?
Well, because of New Hampshire. See, because that's not, this, like, we've done, I don't know, three, four, we do five of these. I've done 20 town hall meetings now. You build this from the bottom up. Getting the police chief in Woodstock is a big deal. I mean, we think we're going to get, ultimately, I got to work them over a couple more times, we're going to get the guy that owns a general store. But we have like 60 town leaders now who have signed up, and that's where you get it done. You don't get it done doing a dance in the end zone. You get it done in the spring when you start working and building and doing the things you need to do. So I'm thrilled we don't have a national primary. National primary would all be about name ID. I don't have a lot of name ID because I was taking care of Ohio. I wasn't, doing any of these other things. So I believe that through these early, Iowa, New Hampshire, South Carolina, that's how you build. And, New Hampshire should be renamed Cape Canaveral because when somebody does well here, they get launched into the public consciousness. So it's how you build the innards. It's not about, how much you yell or scream, because if that was the case, I wouldn't do it. And I've been elected a bunch of times, and I know how you build a campaign. Yes?
Hi. Thank thank you for being here, and I just want to say thank you. Thank you for your stance on immigration reform. You are holding the right side of stance on immigration.
Just maybe they don't know. So I'm for finishing the wall. I'm for having a guest worker program, and for the ones that are here that have been law-abiding, they get to stay. They're going to have to pay a penalty. I'm not going to go round in all the neighborhoods and try to put them on a bus and ship them to the border. That's just not America, and it wouldn't work. It's dumb.
Absolutely. And so thank you for just holding that position for both tech and business and for the undocumented. And so my question to you is, you've been excellent on this issue, and so will you ever get to the point, do you think, where you'd be open to these law-abiding undocumented citizens, immigrants who pay their back taxes, get in the back of the line? Would you be willing someday to let them have a pathway to citizenship?
No, because you cannot jump the line and be rewarded. Pardon? No, I wouldn't.
They're getting the back of the line. They're not going
to
jump the line.
Well, you mean they're going to have to leave and come in under the normal processes?
Well, they'd stay here.
Well, no, then if they stay here, they jump the line. So the answer is, let's get them.
Become citizens 15 years later.
I'm not for it. Okay? I am for people being able to have legal status, but I am not for citizenship because... I just don't subscribe to the fact that if you jump the line, it at any point ought to be rewarded for it. You know, I made the comment, you know, months ago that you know, I wouldn't die on that hill, but I am not for that. It goes against the things that I try to teach my kids, which is don't break the rules. Just don't break the rules. And so I don't want to ship them out. They're a very important part of our society, of our economy. But I don't like the idea of citizenship. Sorry. Yes?
How would you fix the corruption in Washington now among the special interest group? You probably left before it was so rampant.
No, it's just always been the same.
What would you do to try to fix it?
But when you talk about corruption, there aren't, like, a lot of crooks down there.
Really?
No. No, I mean, there's not a lot of people down there that are, like, stealing money. I mean, they just aren't. What has happened in Washington is that the people in that town have had too much influence on the people who go there to make the laws. Do you think they're, like, stealing stuff?
Okay.
Is that what you thought, or did you just think the system's pretty doesn't work? Well, yeah, there's a...
The
yeah.
Who have such great influence, and it's probably favors and money and other things.
Look, I'm governor of the 7th largest state. Do you know how many interest groups there are out there? We have 11.5 million people. It's the same everywhere. But interest groups, okay, who are interest groups? They represent farmers. Everybody sitting in this room is represented by some interest group. And if you're in the military, you got an interest group. If you are a farmer, you got an interest group. If you're a teacher, you have an interest group. See, people don't think about it that way. But the way in which you should pick somebody is, I consider myself to be a CEO more than I think of myself as governor. And it is my job to make the choices I need to make, and even if it makes people upset, that's okay. Somebody once said to me that my greatest talent is to get people to do what they know they should do, but they don't want to do. Do you know how hard it is to get people to balance a budget? I mean, do you have any idea how many people get upset? But you know what? If we don't do it, our children pay the price. So you have to build the moral case as to why we need to think bigger than ourselves. And we're sort of back to something I mentioned earlier about living a life bigger than ourselves. Remember the guy in the white cassock and the little white beanie? Mm-hmm. Came to America and he said, you know, we have to live a life bigger than ourselves. Isn't that a great thought? You know, and I got to tell you something, what I believe, another thought I believe.
Can I tell them who wore that hat?
Well, they know it was the Pope.
Yeah.
And he revived their country for about 3 days. And it's like he never even visited. It's like he visited 100 years ago. But isn't it great when you can live a life a little bigger than yourself?
Yep.
Last night I was talking, do we have anybody in here who's been widowed? Anybody in here who's a widow? No?
Yeah.
But there was a man last night. He had been married for 45 years and lost his wife 2 years ago. I said, anybody here invited him to dinner?
interesting.
But isn't that what we need to do, ma'am?
Reach out.
Reach out.
Yeah.
Reach out. That's what we have to be. So when we're back to her question, though. So I have people come into my office and they say, we really don't like this thing. Listen to them. If they make sense, fine, but there's a larger goal out here. There's a larger goal, and you just have to tell them no. I went from $8 billion, almost 20% of our budget in the hole, to a surplus. How do you think I did that? I didn't bring in, who's that magician? I mean, and I'll give you a good example. I had to fight the nursing home industry. They have very high reimbursement rates. They spent millions of dollars to defeat me as governor because they knew I was going to change things. And then when I won, they ran a $1 million campaign saying I was going to throw grandma on the streets. And all I wanted to do was get their reimbursement rates to a level that was still too high, probably today. I wanted to bring it down, and I wanted mom and dad to be able to stay in their own home if they were able to do it instead of being put in a nursing home. Okay, that's what I was for. And the industry didn't like it. So I went down to make a speech. And I took the contribution list of some of the members of the Ohio Senate, and I started to read it. And then the president of the Senate got very upset. I said, well, there's no reason to be upset. Just do what I want. And they did. And they did. Do you got what I'm saying? And they did. In 1993, Bill Clinton was raising taxes, and I had an alternative plan that wouldn't have required a tax increase. So we had a Republican meeting, and I had the specific proposal as to how I would do this. So we had this Republican meeting. We had 28 speakers, and 26 of them said Kasich's plan should never be put out because the specifics will get us in trouble politically, and we will get beaten in the next election. So I walked back to Newt, and I said, Newt, how are we doing? We got 26 against us and 2 for us. He said, we're actually doing better than I thought we'd be doing. My plan went out. Right. Joe Scarborough, you know who he is?
Yeah.
He says, the reason why I ran for Congress is because of what they were doing up there. We ended up passing the balanced budget. So you can overcome the special interests, but you got to look people right in the eye. And you got to say, what are you here for? Why are you here in this job? I once had a guy, I can't tell this because it'll all be taken the wrong way, but no, he was a guy, he had a lot of kids. And he was begging me not to force him to make some votes. And I said, your kids live in California and you're here. Why are you here? Are you here for yourself, your children, the country? What are you, okay, I will never bother you again. There is a certain skill and magic that you must have to get people to do what they don't want to do, but they know they should. And you can't yell at them. You can't be on, you know, American Idol yelling something and they don't care about you. They don't care about your money, your position, your power, what kind of car you drive, what kind of boat you have. Congressmen don't think that way. They don't care. So you got to have somebody that can go in there and inspire them to think about the country before themselves or their political party or their ideology. It's a hell of a tough thing to get done. And that's why I sometimes wonder why I'm doing this. Because it's hard. Yes, sir. Then we'll go to the lady in front.
Democrats have suggested that it's unrealistic to think we could balance the budget in 10 years, the federal budget. This seems ridiculous to me. Could you commit to balancing the federal budget in 10 years?
Would you come to Nashua, New Hampshire tomorrow and watch me unveil my plan? Get his phone number. I'm going to call him tomorrow, okay? So he won't drive to Nashua for a balanced budget. I could talk you into it if I tried long enough. I will call you tomorrow, sir. We're going to be unveiling a plan that's going to be very exciting that you're going to want to see. And you know what? Somebody sent me an email this morning that Hillary Clinton said last, they asked, who is it that you made an enemy of? And she bragged that she made enemies out of Republicans?
Yep. That's exactly what she
said. Hey, is that where this country's going? the leading candidate for the Democrat nomination is bragging about the fact that Republicans don't like her, and she's proud of that?
Yeah.
I gotta tell you, that's a disgrace.
Yes.
That is a D-I-S-G-R-A-C-E. Got it? I don't ever want to brag about the fact that I can't get along with people. I want to talk about putting the country back together again. Do you want the election that badly? If that's how badly you want it, you shouldn't have it. Mm-hmm. You just shouldn't have it. Yes, ma'am. That is really, that's just ridiculous. Yes, ma'am.
I was going to comment on your suggestions before, John.
I don't think it will take 10 years to balance the budget, sir. Okay, your question.
Looking people in the eye and how difficult it is, this Congress seems to be a different...
Looking in my eyes. I love these town hall meetings. Are you having fun here today? I hope you're learning. Is this okay for all of you, huh?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, go ahead, ma'am.
This Congress seems to be a different animal. You said you left and everything went in the pot or whatever. I'm wondering, how are you going to deal with all the obstruction? I mean, is there anything...
First of all, it wasn't just me. It was a group of us that left, and because you don't do anything as one person. You have to build a team. My buddy here drove 8 hours from Maryland. He's not in Congress anymore, but he was there through some of the toughest times, and you build a team. Secondly, you cannot lead really from the legislature, because no one has the stature, no one has the position by which to gather people. It's like a flock without a shepherd. And people can try to lead. I mean, it was one of the things that we saw for a short time in the 90s when we won the majority and Newt was there and we tried to lead. But over time, you cannot really lead from there. It takes an executive. And the reason why the Republicans are wandering around is because they don't have a national leader. Mm-hmm. And once you get a national leader with an agenda of accomplishing things, trade, energy, regulation, taxes, balancing budgets, once you have an agenda, then there's something that people can rally to. But right now, there's no one with the stature, and there's no way you can do it. But I believe that with an aggressive plan, you see, tomorrow I'm gonna release a framework for what I intend to do to present to the Congress in the first 100 days. I'm not going to go there and say, okay, what are we going to do now? You've got to be ready to roll, and you've got to rally people, and that's what leadership is. A good shepherd makes things work better. Yes, miss?
In terms of energy, I have a two-part question. What is your position on industrial wind and the subsidies encouraging it? And second part is, do you believe the government should be picking winners and losers?
Well, I don't like the idea of government picking winners and losers, because normally when they pick losers. And we've seen that with, like, Solyndra. But I think basic research is very important, both in health and in science, basic and applied research, not winners and losers. In terms of renewables, I'm for renewables, and I am very fearful I'm going to get into a battle. I'm not really that fearful, but I don't want to get into a battle with my legislature, because they're not too keen on renewables. And I think we should have all of the above. Wind, and I'm for putting wind turbines outside of every single capital in the U.S. Think of the wind power. No, I'm for wind. I'm for solar. I'm for cleaning coal. We do fracking in Ohio. I'm for natural gas. I'm for energy independence for North America. And that will give a stronger economy and reduce our influence on countries that we can't always rely upon. In terms of wind, or, you know, any of the things that we can capture from industry that is part of the solution, I'm for. And there are benefits to being able to capture certain energy capabilities that come from business, and we should do that. We should use everything we can get our hands on to create energy independence. Yes.
So do you feel it's appropriate to
overly subsidize some sources of energy while not others?
Well, look, I mean, that's always a tricky question. The answer to that is, you know, for example, we have some subsidies on ethanol right now. They're not going to go away, but ultimately these things are going to have to stand on their own. And I think we have to, but I also think it's important that we have renewables. So there's a balance involved, and I'd have to look at what the specific subsidy program would be to make that determination. I don't fundamentally like the idea of doing that. But, you know, I remember when the Internet started, I was one of the authors of a proposal to say we shouldn't tax anything on the Internet. We wanted to get it up and going. So sometimes it's, you know, you've got to think about it in terms of the long-term prospects. Yes, sir, back there.
We have now gone into a huge debate about whether the energy transition in Germany works or doesn't work, and it looks like it will not work. We have 30,000 wind turbines now scattered across Germany. It's an area which is like New England, with a part of state of New York, and we have times where all the 30,000 wind turbines produce no energy at all.
Right.
They are official figures, you cannot question that. The question is, how renewable is wind energy?
Well, here's the thing. What we really want, and we have to be careful, we have to continue to work on the basic science around batteries. Because when batteries are able, we have the breakthrough in batteries, and we're able to store energy. Because, you know, in Ohio, I mean, solar is not that big a deal in some areas, but if we were able to store the energy that comes from renewables, what a wonderful thought that is. And that's called distributed power. And so, you know, the idea that that these turbines can produce at a time, that the solar can produce at a time, that we can store energy, including for our automobiles, this is going to happen at some point. And we're going to see a big transformation of the way in which we live, and it's beginning now. But there'll be more. Thank you. I got to keep going. Yes, ma'am.
At the beginning of the of your presentation, I believe you said something about beefing up the military.
Yes.
How do you do that?
Spend money.
Yeah. You got it.
We're going to have to spend money, but we have to reform the Pentagon. We have too many people there gumming up the works. Yep. So you have to have somebody there that knows how to reform it so that the money we spend actually goes to the things that we need and doesn't go to waste or bureaucracy or red tape or delay or any of that other stuff. But we're going to have to spend more. We just cannot, and as a president, I'm going to have to keep an eye on that Pentagon, and it's going to be a very tricky decision as to who could be the Secretary of Defense who could do both things, reform the building while strengthening the military. And it's very tricky, because I know, because I've been in the middle of that. Yes?
Going off of that question, I kind of want to know your idea on military, and do you want a more military, foreign military?
What are we going to do around the world?
Yeah. You kind of want to pull back?
Yeah. No, I don't want to pull back, because if you pull back, then bad people move in.
Yeah.
So Ukraine, we should arm the people that want to defend themselves. We don't have to go there. Okay. But if Putin wants to move into the Baltics, that's would be a disaster for the world, because we're not going to let them do it. In Syria, I'm for a no-fly zone, for a sanctuary, for people to go and be safe. I'd be for two of them. And if somebody flies into the no-fly zone, you see, when you come from the Keys Rocks, when you tell somebody, don't fly into my no-fly zone, and they fly into your no-fly zone, they don't fly into your no-fly zone, okay? They may fly into it once, but they won't do it again, I can promise you. And ISIS, we have to go kill ISIS. We have to get our friends and neighbors from Germany and from the Middle East, and we got to wipe them out. And so we should go where our direct interests are involved, but we should help people who want to help themselves. We should not undercut our friends, like the Israelis or the Egyptians, but we ought to have some tough talk with the Saudis about the fact that
You know, they got to stop funding all these radical clerics who are out there spreading hatred, and it's ridiculous. So I'm not going to be holding any Saudis' hands in the near future, believe me. Yes, ma'am. Oh, and then we'll go one more. Yes. This is it.
Okay. The first question had to do about Cuba.
Yeah.
I am one of those people that came 15 years ago. I listened yesterday to the debate, and I'm terrified about Bernie Sanders, simply because such a rose-colored picture of what socialism is. Then I heard the same things I heard 50 years ago. Maybe it wasn't Wall Street, but it was agrarian reform and everybody having something. That completely destroyed a nation that was third in this hemisphere, including Canada and the United States. And nobody says anything about it. It's like a movie that's so nice to give away college education and taking care of babies. Why would you be against that? Why would you be against that? Nobody fights it and say, no, it's not that. It's not like that.
Yes.
Look at the horrors around us.
Yeah. Well, look, can I get you to be for me? Okay, well, you think about it hard, because we're not going in that direction if I'm president, okay?
But I'm afraid of the lies.
They're not going to win. Bernie Sanders is not going to win. He may be good with Ben and Jerry's ice cream, but that's about as far as it goes. Okay, right here. And I know him. Don't worry. He has no influence.
You won the popular one.
Oh, well, don't worry about it. I don't want you to worry about it. He is not going to be the president of the United States. I mean, that's just not going to happen. You get the last question.
Recently in Iowa, you told voters that you didn't think that the country should act on climate change because it would put people out of their jobs. But a recent survey in your state found that 89,000 people were working at 7,200 clean energy businesses. So doesn't this show that addressing the threat of climate change helps build new industries and keep good paying American jobs?
Okay. Well, I never said that in Iowa, so you got to go back. And what I said is that I do believe that human behavior influences climate, but we don't know to which degree. And what I don't want to do is have you not get a job because we took some action that was preliminary before we could determine the amount of impact. Because if I unemploy you, not only are you going to be mad, but so are your parents after they spent the money to educate you. So I don't want to make everybody angry. The other thing I wanted to tell you is, just because everybody shouts something at you doesn't make it right. That's leadership, right? The willingness to walk a lonely road. So while I think that we have to be careful about this, and I am sensitive about the environment, we need to be careful with the environment. I've been riding in the front of the bus. What a beautiful state you have here, right? And I don't want to destroy this, but we have to. Economic growth in a clean environment is not inconsistent. So guess what? I got to get back on my bus. So I'm done, and I want to thank you for coming here. And if you like me, we need you to sign up and become part of our team. Thank you all very much.